MedCram.com.
Welcome to another MedCram video. We're going to talk about palliative care in the intensive care unit and what we call a terminal extubation or terminal weaning. And as we talked about in the first video, these are the type of patients in situations where we've done full force, full code, everything that we got, all the stops pulled out, and these are on patients who are really sick and have responded halfway in terms of we're supporting the pillar of the heart pillar that's fallen down. We've supported the pillar of the lungs, for instance, which has fallen down. And also, let's say the patient's on dialysis because the kidney pillar has fallen down. And let's say that the patient is on antibiotics because the immune system pillar has fallen down. And so what we're doing in these situations is the patient's very sick and we're holding up the positions of these pillars to keep this patient viable in the ICU. The problem is that we hold up these areas. There's risks with that, right? So the longer we have vasopressors on, the more likely the patient is going to get tissue breakdown and necrosis in the extremities. The longer that the patient is on a ventilator, that increases the risk of ventilator-associated pneumonia. The longer the patient is on hemodialysis, that can cause infections in the dialysis catheters. And the longer the patient is on antibiotics, that can cause other issues as well and side effects, thrombocytopenia, elevated LFTs, etc. So we're holding up the patient here, but the pillars, which we ultimately need to have come up, are not coming up. They should be coming up, but they're not coming up. We're stuck holding up the roof. And sometimes what can happen, you know, some people have different values than others. A family would say, look, he would not want to be on this ventilator for more than a week or two. And it's already been 3 weeks. So we just can't stand the way he's suffering anymore. He would not want to be in this situation. What do we do? And so what we do in that situation is we have to pull back the support of these positions that are holding up the roof with the understanding that what's going to happen is this roof is going to fall and the patient's going to pass away in the intensive care unit. But the way we want to do that is in the most gentle and the most dignified way that we possibly can. And the one I want to focus on specifically is this lung pillar, because pulling out an endotracheal tube out of somebody could cause them shortness of breath and discomfort, things that we exactly don't want to do in the intensive care unit. So if we're in that situation, what I tell patients is that, look, we've been here in the intensive care unit, we've been trying to do everything that we can to make him better from a bodily standpoint, and we haven't been able to do it. So instead of trying to make the patient better from a bodily pathophysiological standpoint, and at the same time trying to treat his pain in a way that doesn't interfere with our blood pressure and things of that nature, now what we're going to do is we're going to switch to making him perfectly comfortable and not worry about those secondary side effects of morphine or Dilaudid or benzodiazepines, and that's called palliative care. So we always want to make sure that patients are comfortable, but the problem is sometimes the medications that we use to make patients comfortable have negative side effects. For instance, they can drop the blood pressure. When we get to this situation where we cannot make the patient better and we've come to that decision, then we can concentrate fully on making the patient comfortable as possible. And now what we're doing is we're going to treat to the fullest extent that the patient is comfortable and not be worried about a drop in blood pressure and not be worried about a drop in consciousness and things of that nature. So what are the things that we're looking at? We want to treat pain. And the way we can look at pain is we can look at heart rate, because sometimes the patient can't talk to us. So we can look at heart rate. We can look at facial expressions, so a furrowed brow or a look of pain. We can look at the respiratory rate, all sorts of things that we can look at to see for pain. So what we'll do is we'll treat the patient. We can take off things that are not comfortable but are not necessarily supportive. We can make sure that the patient is pain-free. So that would mean starting a morphine drip or a Versed drip, a fentanyl drip, what have you. And then what we start to do is we look at the ventilator and we start to pull back the support. So if the patient is on AC mode ventilation, we'll start to back off. We'll maybe put the patient on SIMV mode ventilation and we'll start to back off on the rate. We may back off on the pressure support, and we do it in a stepwise fashion. And every point along the way, we're always checking heart rate, facial expressions, respiratory rate. And if we start to see that those are going in a direction of pain, so if the heart rate's going up, if there's facial expression of pain, if there's respiratory rate that's going up, we stop at that point. We don't go any further, and we make sure that we're increasing the pain medication to make sure that those heart rate, facial expression, respiratory rate go back to normal. Once they go back to normal, we continue to pull back the support from the ventilator until finally, in a stepwise fashion, the ventilator is completely off, and then we can pull the tube out. And I always tell family, look, the purpose here is not to have your loved one pass away in the intensive care unit. The purpose of this is to make sure that the patient is comfortable. And I can tell you, sometimes in my experience, I've seen patients pass away even before we've taken the endotracheal tube out. And sometimes we've seen situations where the endotracheal tube comes out and the patient does well and actually lives for a number of days or weeks afterwards. But the point of this is not to have the patient pass away. The point of this is to make sure that the patient is comfortable. And if the patient is able to support themselves after we pull off the support from the ventilator or the vasopressors or the dialysis or whatever it is, if the patient's able to support themselves, so be it. The point is the patient's going to be comfortable, the patient doesn't want to have any more of these invasive measures, and the patient should be in control. And the part of all of this that's sort of granting all of this is the ethical principle of autonomy. So autonomy is big, especially in Western culture. Autonomy means that patients themselves are able to determine for themselves what medical treatment they should have and what medical treatment they don't want to have. So it's okay for them to refuse medical treatment, even if it means that they're going to have a shortened life expectancy. This has to be mitigated with your understanding, of course, of whether or not the patient is in their right mind. Point is that what we believe in Western culture is that patients should have the ability to determine for themselves what treatments they have and what treatments they don't, realizing that these treatments sometimes have a lot of side effects. They're painful. They're uncomfortable. So this is a discussion that I think has to be open-minded. In the final analysis of all of this, when we wrap all of this up, the point is this, is that the medical doctor, the medical professional, the healthcare professional needs to come to the family with realistic expectations about how things are going. And the family needs to bring, and the patient themselves, if they can, need to bring information to the healthcare decision makers about what the values are of the patient, what they would have wanted given those set of prognosis. And then together, both family and the professional need to come up with a decision about what the direction is for the patient. Sometimes I have noticed that healthcare professionals don't bring up these alternatives, and so they don't feel like the family doesn't feel that this is a alternative that they can actually go down. So it's important as a healthcare professional to bring up these different options in a dignified way so that patients and families can make their decisions. So I hope this was helpful in terms of understanding what DNR means, what DNI means, CPR, palliative care, what it is that we do in the intensive care unit. And I hope that this will further your medical experience in the intensive care unit and your dealings with patients about this very difficult discussion. Thanks for joining us.